Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Raven's Shadow by James E. Wisher. Narrated by Joe Hempel. Heading home. Conryu yawned, snuggled deeper into his soft chair, and glanced out the window. The train was pulling into Central Station. In the distance, the black department building drew his eye. Despite being only half as tall as some of the surrounding skyscrapers, it still managed to dominate the skyline. It was probably the aura of the unnatural that surrounded it. Either that or the presence of Kelsey's grandmother inside twisted reality. Speaking of which, he'd offered to let Kelsey ride with them, but she'd insisted on staying in her private cabin. She claimed to be tired, but Conryu suspected she felt like a third wheel when Maria was around. He really hoped the two girls eventually learned to get along. He was very fond of both of them, and it would make his life a lot easier if they liked each other at least a little. Across from him, Maria had her nose buried in one of the books she'd brought home with her. Why on earth she'd want to do more studying after all they'd done at school this past year baffled him. The only reason he'd brought Prime was because he had no choice. A powerful bond connected him to the Scholomantic. If they were separated by more than 100 or so yards, the results would be painful for them both. The brakes whined as the train slowed and came to a stop. The majority of the students would disembark here before boarding trains to other parts of the Alliance. Conryu and Maria had the good fortune, at least good fortune in terms of avoiding potential assassins, not to have to leave their cabin. The whole car would be added to the train headed for Sentinel City. Maria looked up from her book. Are we there? We're at the capital, but we've still got a long way to go. Oh. She lowered her face back to the book and was instantly lost in her own world. Conryu shook his head and smiled. Must be nice. Of course, Prime would like nothing better than to spend every moment cramming his head full of new spells. Conryu was a good deal less enthusiastic about studying, preferring to learn what he needed when he needed it. His hope was that he wouldn't need any magic this summer. In the hall outside, a door slammed, and a moment later a muffled voice protested. Maria looked up again. What was that? Beats me. Conryu strode over and opened the door. A big guy in a black suit had Kelsey by the wrist and was dragging her toward the exit. A second man had her bags. Hey! All three turned to look at him. What the hell are you two doing? The man with the bags scowled through his goatee. Ms. Kincaid is coming home with us. Return to your cabin and there won't be any trouble. You think you can kidnap my friend and there won't be any trouble? He stepped out into the hall. Let her go and get lost. Then there won't be any trouble. Conryu, these are my mom's private security guards. If she told them to bring me home, they won't let me go. Do you want to go with them? No. He glared at the men in black through narrowed eyes. Then we have a problem. The nearest man tossed Kelsey's bags to the ground and reached under his coat. When Conryu saw the pistol, he threw his hand forward. Shatter! The gun burst into a handful of metal filings. In the guard's moment of surprise, Conryu stepped in with a snap kick to the side of his knee. When the guard's knee hit the hall floor, Conryu spun into a slashing elbow to his opponent's temple. The guard's head thumped off the wall, and he collapsed in a heap. The second guard appeared uncertain whether he should release Kelsey and fight or try and drag her out of the train car. Conryu stepped over the unconscious figure and advanced down the hall. The still-standing guard thrust Kelsey in front of him. Don't come any closer. Or what? You expect me to believe you might hurt your employer's daughter? Conryu concentrated on Kelsey. Cloak of darkness. Liquid black covered Kelsey from head to toe. Gah! The guard thrust her away from him. He clearly had no idea what the spell did, just as Conryu had hoped. Conryu pulled Kelsey behind him. Maria stood in the doorway and held out her hand. Come on! Kelsey hesitated for just a moment before ducking into the cabin. Maria nodded to him, slammed the door shut, and snapped the lock. Conryu stared at the still conscious guard. Just you and me now. If you want to leave, I promise I won't tell anyone. The guard fell into a fighting stance. You took Freddy by surprise. I won't go down so easy. Did you see what I did to his gun? I could do that to your head just as easily. The guard's Adam's apple bobbed as sweat poured down his face. Conryu didn't actually know if such a simple spell would blast the guard's head to bits, though it stood to reason the spell affected living flesh as well as it did non-living material. The truth was, even if it did work that way, he wouldn't do it. But Freddy's pal didn't know that. The guard lowered his fists. You don't understand. If we go back without Lady Kincaid's daughter, she'll fire us at best. Conryu didn't have much sympathy for men who would kidnap a girl just because their employer told them to. Try to look on the bright side. At least you'll still be alive to search for a new job. He stepped back over Freddy, who was now groaning on the floor, and stood beside his cabin door. Conryu raised his hand. Take him and go. Last warning. All right. Just so you know, I'm blaming you for all this. The guard collected his partner, and the pair of them stumbled off the train. Conryu sighed and lowered his hand. They'd bought his bluff. Thank goodness. Conryu waited until the two goons were off the train before he turned and knocked. They're gone. Let me in. A second later, the lock clicked open and he slid the door aside. Maria returned to her seat across from Kelsey, who was still covered in his cloak of darkness spell. Conryu waved his hand, and the darkness vanished. The guard's tight grip had raised a set of nasty bruises on Kelsey's wrist. You okay? He asked.
Yeah, but Mom's going to be really mad. I mean, I knew she wasn't going to be happy I ignored her order, but I never thought she'd send two of her personal bodyguards to drag me home. Let me see your arm.
Maria gently took Kelsey's bruised wrist in her hand. She chanted a spell and a bright glow surrounded her hand. She rubbed the injuries and Kelsey sighed.
You know, Maria said, I wasn't thrilled when Conryu invited you to come for a visit. But if this is how your family treats you, I'm starting to think he should have offered to let you stay longer. There.
The glow disappeared, revealing smooth, healed skin.
Thank you.
Kelsey lunged across the little table and hugged Maria.
For everything.
Conryu grinned and went back out to collect Kelsey's bags. He'd have to thank Kelsey's mother. Her thug's attack had done more to make Maria sympathetic to her problems than anything he could have said. Maybe, just maybe, the two of them would start getting along better now. He brought the bags inside and set them in the corner. There wasn't room enough in the overhead storage for two more suitcases. There also weren't enough chairs for all of them. He shrugged and sat on the floor, using her bags as a backrest.
I'm sorry, Kelsey started to get up. I'm taking your chair. Don't worry about it.
He waved her back into the seat.
I doubt Dumb and Ugly will be back, but I'll feel better if I know where you are. I heard you talking through the door. Kelsey sat back down. Would you have really killed that guy? Nah, I'm not even sure if Shatter will work on living flesh.
In the storage area, Conryu's bag shifted and bounced. He sighed, stood up, and unzipped it. A t-shirt flew out and zoomed around the cabin like a cheap Halloween ghost. Prime's muffled voice was unintelligible.
Hold still.
Prime hovered over the table and Conryu pulled the shirt off him.
What did you want?
I eavesdropped on your conversation, and since it is my duty to educate you, I attempted to escape and do so. Shatter isn't an effective spell for killing. That said, it's a simple thing for a powerful dark wizard to kill. All you need to do is focus on your target and say, die, in Infernal.
That sounds way too easy, Conryu said.
The spell is simple. Making it work is hard. You have to genuinely want the spell's target to die with all your will. The least bit of doubt in the spell will fail. I hesitate to find fault, Master, but I fear you lack the capacity to kill with magic. You're too kind-hearted.
Maria shook her head. That's not a fault. If Conryu could casually kill someone, he wouldn't be who he is.
The cabin fell silent for a minute before Kelsey asked,
So how long to reach Sentinel City? The mood lightened at once, and Conryu settled back on his makeshift couch. He really didn't want to kill anyone, but as a warrior, he knew enough to realize the day would come when he'd have to make a choice. He wouldn't always be able to win while leaving his enemies alive. 4 or 5 hours on the train, plus however long it takes to drive to our building. Maria reached for her bag. I have extra books if you'd like something to read.
No, thank you. I don't think I could concentrate. I'm just going to rest my eyes and try to take a nap.
That sounded like an excellent idea, but Conryu was too keyed up to sleep. After half an hour or so, the train got underway again. When they moved out of sight of Central City, he finally allowed himself to relax. Sometime later, the train jerked. Conryu's eyes popped open and he was halfway to his feet before he noticed the station out the window. He must have dozed off after all. He twisted his neck from side to side to work the stiffness out. Kelsey was softly snoring, and he hated to wake her, but he didn't have enough hands to carry her and the bags. He gave her shoulder a shake, and she groaned.
Come on, wake up. We're here.
She blinked and sat up straight. Maria held out a napkin and tapped her chin. Kelsey wiped the drool off while turning beet red. She crumpled up the napkin and climbed out of her chair while Conryu collected his and Maria's bags.
Think your parents will be here? Conryu asked.
Maria shrugged and opened the door.
No idea. I can't get a straight answer whenever I ask about what's happening. I can tell Dad's stressed to the max, and it's rubbing off on Mom. I hope at least one of them's here, but I'm not holding my breath.
At least your parents aren't going to send someone to try and kidnap you, Kelsey said.
Maria laughed. True, but not sending kidnappers is a pretty low bar. From what Conryu's told me, I wouldn't trade parents with you for the world. They made their way to the car door and climbed down to the platform. Since they were in the last cabin, in the last car, everyone had already disembarked and was making their way toward the lobby. The trio followed along at an easy pace.
Think we can coax Mom into taking us to Giovanni's for dinner?
Conryu adjusted his grip on Maria's bag.
I don't know, but that's an excellent plan. When's Johnny getting in?
I'm pretty sure he said the day after tomorrow.
Who's Johnny?
Kelsey asked. Another old friend, Conryu grinned. He's attending military school. His plan is to be deployed to Florida and defend scantily clad beach babes from zombies.
That doesn't sound very likely. Kelsey glanced back at him. He knows that, right?
He should. I've told him often enough.
Johnny? Conryu Koda!
Running down the platform was Kat Gable and her unlucky cameraman, Joe.
Oh, for Christ's sake. Can't I get off the train just once without that lunatic waiting for me?
Kelsey turned to face him.
You know Kat? Sort of. She's my personal stalker. The woman is incapable of taking no for an answer.
Do you know her? Maria asked.
Sure. She's interviewed me and my mom half a dozen times. Kat handles all the magic-related interviews for her network. She's tough, but fair. The one time my mom threatened to buy her station and fire her.
Kat reached them and thrust her microphone in Conryu's face.
How did you enjoy your first year at the Arcane Academy?
Conryu glared into the camera.
Shatter.
The lens cracked and sparks shot out the back.
Fuck me.
Joe dropped the camera and danced away a second before it burst into flames. Conryu turned his gaze on Kat. No comment. She lowered the microphone and frowned.
How long are we going to have to play this game? Why don't you just give me the interview and we can both move on? If you want it to be over, all you need to do is stop showing up wherever I am. I don't owe you a thing.
Kat shook her head, then her eyes went wide.
Kelsey Kincaid? I didn't even notice you there. What brings you to Sentinel City?
Visiting friends. Nice to see you again, Kat.
We need to go. I imagine my mom's getting impatient.
Conryu stalked past the now silent Kat.
Bye.
Kelsey waved to the reporter and fell in behind him with Maria bringing up the rear. When they were outside of Kat's range of hearing, Maria said,
Did you make his camera explode?
Conryu offered his best innocent look.
Me?
Yeah, You. Did I cast a spell? No. There you go.
They left the platform, and after a quick search through the mini-hugging family, spotted Conryu's mom standing near one of the pillars on the right side of the entry area. She saw them at the same moment and waved before running over and hugging him. After half a minute and several kisses, Conryu wiggled free.
Hey, Mom. Dad waiting in the car?
Of course.
Mom turned her attention to Kelsey.
Aren't you going to introduce me?
Sorry. Mom, meet Kelsey Kincaid.
Kelsey, my mom.
They shook hands, and Kelsey said,
Thanks so much for letting me stay with you. I hope I won't be too much of a bother.
Not at all, dear.
Sho and I are always glad to meet a friend of Conryu's, and such a famous one. I'm afraid you'll find our little apartment smaller than you're used to.
Kelsey smiled.
At school, I share a room with 11 other girls, so rooming with 3 people won't be a problem. Did my parents not come?
Maria's disappointment came through loud and clear.
No, Oren asked me to give you a ride home.
Your mom was called out of the city on an emergency consultation, and he's been working crazy hours at the department. I have no idea what's happening, but everyone's nerves are stretched tight.
Maria slumped, and Conryu wanted to give her a hug, but his hands were overloaded as it was. He couldn't have been more pleased when Kelsey did it for him. Even better, Maria didn't shrug her off. Summer was looking to be a good deal more pleasant than he'd first feared. Kelsey screamed when Conryu opened the throttle on his bike and they roared down the highway. She'd never ridden on a motorcycle before. Her mother said they were too dangerous. As she clutched Conryu's chest and watched the cars whiz by, she thought she might have finally found something she and her mother agreed on. What Kelsey couldn't deny was the thrill of it. Her heart raced and tears streamed down her face both from the wind and the excitement. It also provided an excellent excuse to hug Conryu, which was something she'd never pass up. He shot past a bus and she tightened her grip. When he'd shown her the gleaming black bike this morning, she never imagined flying down the road at 90 miles an hour, her hair snapping behind her in the wind. Last night had been her first experience sleeping on a couch, and it was much nicer than she'd expected. Conryu's mother had fixed it up like a proper bed with soft sheets and a warm, snuggly blanket. She'd been so sweet, doing everything short of tucking Kelsey in to make her feel at home. Kelsey couldn't help contrasting the welcome she'd received from these total strangers with the one her family gave her whenever she came home after a trip. Generally, all she got was a combination of complaints and indifference. She'd been tempted to ask Mrs. Coda to adopt her on the spot, and after the incident on the train, that might still be an option. If nothing else, she now understood why he said he wouldn't trade families with her for all the money in the world. Conryu slewed the bike into the right lane, slowed, and pulled onto the off-ramp. They hadn't really had a destination. A trip was just an excuse for him to take his beloved bike for a spin. After his parents and Maria, Kelsey was pretty sure Conryu loved his bike the most. When he'd uncovered it this morning, he whispered to it and stroked it in a way that made her jealous. Kelsey would have loved to woken up that way. With his parents in the kitchen and Maria 4 floors up, that didn't seem likely. He wove through crowded city streets, to where she couldn't say. 10 minutes later, he pulled into a dirt lot. In the nearby park, workers were building a fence around the perimeter. Conryu switched off the motor, put down the kickstand, and pulled off his helmet. She copied him and shook out her hair, trying to restore some semblance of order.
What is this place?
This is the site of the annual Shadow Carnival. It's also where I was almost murdered for the second time. I'm not entirely sure why I came back here. It was like something drew me.
The flap on his saddlebag rustled and Prime flew out. She'd been so excited by the ride she'd forgotten all about the book.
It's not unusual for the sight of past trauma to haunt a person for years afterward. Don't be concerned, Master. There's nothing wrong with your mind.
As always, Prime, you're a great comfort.
So what happened here?
She'd never heard the whole story about Conryu's many brushes with death, even though she'd lived through one of them. When he finished telling her, she shook her head.
So that's why you were curious about shadow beasts in our first class. I admit, I was wondering.
Why didn't you ask?
I was wary of you right up until my desperation got the best of me. Looking back, I can't believe how many weeks I wasted. If I'd just taken a chance that first day when you talked to me, we could have become friends so much sooner.
We're friends now. That's what counts. He patted her knee. His gaze shifted to the sky. Hanging above them was the huge floating island. She'd seen this one before, though it didn't fly directly over Central. It looked like it was headed right for them, sort of a slow-motion meteor from a movie.
When's the carnival? Kelsey asked.
This weekend, when the island is directly overhead. It'll be so dark you'll think it's night at noon.
Can we go?
I don't know if they'll let me in after what happened last year, but we can try. Maria and I have been going since we were little, so it's a tradition, and Johnny would never pass up a chance at junk food.
How long have you known him?
Conryu had mentioned they were friends, but she didn't know anything else about him.
Since third grade. He arrives from military school tomorrow for a one-month break. Conryu sighed. And I thought we got screwed on vacation time.
So what do you want to do after lunch?
She shrugged. Kelsey was happy to do anything, as long as it was with him.
Lady Raven stood on the small balcony of her redoubt and watched the island creep across the sky. It wouldn't be long now. After a year of sitting on her hands, hiding, and making preparations, at last everything would come together. And not a moment too soon as far as she was concerned. Another month cooped up with nothing but undead for company, and she feared she might go mad. Her black silk robe swirled around her as a warm summer breeze caressed her skin and carried the salty scent of the nearby ocean to her. The blue-green water lay on the opposite side of the building from where she stood. Lady Raven imagined it. The waves. The birds. The mental exercise soothed her for a few seconds before the blast of a ship's horn jolted her out of her reverie. Just as well, really. The final meeting with the Hierarchs was due to begin in 10 minutes. She needed to go back inside and prepare. 3 steps carried her through the French doors and into her bedroom where 2 of the undead bikers she'd taken as her personal bodyguards stood against the wall waiting for orders. She'd left 3 of the others to guard the entrance to her base, and the last was destroyed by Terra and her flunkies. She brushed past her bed, pausing long enough to collect the black raven mask from her nightstand. On her way out, she paused to look at herself in the dressing room mirror. Still old, still wrinkled, but still alive and more powerful than ever. That was an exchange the younger members of the society wouldn't understand for many more years. Satisfied, Lady Raven opened the door and stepped out into the hall. It was a short walk from the bedroom to her casting chamber, intentionally so, as she had to be available night or day for her superiors, especially now that the culmination of their work was so close at hand. Her guards fell in behind automatically. There was no danger to her here, and it seemed foolish to have the lumbering things following her everywhere. But better safe than sorry. The only rule was they weren't allowed in her casting chamber. The nature of their dark magic messed with her spells in unpredictable ways, so they stood guard outside while she stepped into the Spartan chamber. When she first arrived, she'd taken the time to inscribe a permanent spell circle in the floor, thus freeing herself from having to draw it again and again. The mask slipped over her head and settled into its familiar place. When this mission ended, she'd missed the raven mask. But hierarchs all wore animal masks. Only sub-hierarchs wore birds. It was an upgrade she was eager to make. Once inside the circle, she cleared her mind and prepared for her superiors to make contact. 5 minutes later, a faint tingle was followed by the appearance of the hierarchs and Lady Bluejay. Of the horrid Lady Mockingbird, there was no sign.
"All is in readiness?" Lady Dragon asked.
"Yes, mistress. There has been no activity near the new hiding places, and I've seen no activity at the department that concerns me."
"Excellent. Tomorrow we'll release our demands.
The weak men will do what we require or see the streets of their city choked with the dead. As you say, Lady Dragon.
Lady Raven's eyes flicked to the spot usually occupied by her rival. Lady Dragon didn't miss the minute gesture, precisely as she'd hoped.
Lady Mockingbird is dead.
The blunt admission set her on her heels for a moment. Had she so badly failed the hierarchs that they felt the need to eliminate her?
No, we didn't kill her.
Lady Dragon leaned back in an unseen chair.
Her attempt to slay the abomination failed, and her cover was pierced. She fell in battle with the head of dark magic, Angeline Umbra. A worthy foe. Pity about Lady Mockingbird.
Lady Dragon's laugh filled the space.
Spare us your false concern. The hatred between the two of you was well known. To pretend otherwise is an insult to all of us.
Lady Raven bowed her head.
I meant no offense, but I do have a suggestion.
We will hear it, Lady Dragon said.
What if we included turning over the abomination to us as part of our plans? We could let the fools in the department do our work for us. That would be a small thing compared to releasing our leader.
Lady Dragon's mask covered her whole face, hiding her expression. But from the way she leaned forward, Lady Raven hoped her idea had been well received.
An excellent idea. It will be a simple matter to add it with potentially great gains. You will make a fine hierarch, Lady Raven.
Her heart raced upon hearing Lady Dragon's compliment. She had never shown such open favoritism before.
Be ready. Lady Dragon's figure started to fade away. When the time comes, it will be your responsibility to punish the city should their leaders fail to do as we require.
A second later, Lady Raven was alone. None of the others had made so much as a sound. She didn't know what to make of it. Were they distancing themselves in case she failed? Or had Lady Dragon given orders for them to remain silent? There was no way for her to know, and that fact frightened her almost as much as the completion of her mission excited her. In a few days, her fate would be sealed one way or the other.
Ultimatum.
Long time no see, bro.
Johnny stepped through the door and bumped fists with Conryu. In the 10 months since Conryu'd last seen his second oldest friend, Johnny had traded his ripped jeans for fatigues, gotten a military spec buzz cut, and put on about 10 pounds of muscle. His already bronzed skin had darkened, and unless Conryu was mistaken, he'd gotten a new scar on his right arm. Looks like the army agrees with you. Conryu motioned him to the couch and shut the door. Johnny managed 2 steps before he froze. Kelsey was sitting on the couch with a slightly nervous smile. She had on a scoop-neck red dress that hugged her curves in a way that would annoy Maria when she arrived with the food. Conryu smacked his forehead with his palm. He'd forgotten to mention Kelsey would be visiting in his last letter.
Who's the babe? And does Maria know she's here?
Johnny couldn't stop looking. Not that Conryu blamed him.
Johnny Salazar, meet Kelsey Kincaid. Kelsey, this is Johnny.
They shook hands and Conryu gave his friend a playful shove toward the recliner before sitting beside Kelsey. So how was your first year?
Boring. Dude, you wouldn't believe it. Every day, marching, calisthenics, shooting, and more marching. On the plus side, they give us 3 squares a day and the guns were fun. So was the hand-to-hand combat training. I learned some good tricks.
Yeah? Maybe a sparring match is in order.
Maybe give me another year to practice.
What about you? Anyone try to kill you lately?
Not for a week or so. Johnny's laugh slowly died when no one else joined in.
Shit, you're serious.
What was it this time? More religious nuts?
I wish. It was a giant 3-headed elemental monster called a chimera. The monster tried to burn me, drown me, and crush me. I came through it okay, but it was a near thing for Kelsey. Johnny turned his gaze on Kelsey.
He's a dangerous guy to hang around with. Did he tell you about the time we were almost eaten by these big black dogs?
Prime chose that moment to come flying out of his bedroom.
Master, your friend's lack of knowledge regarding the Shadowhounds is appalling. I felt it was my duty to come and explain.
To Johnny's credit, his reaction to seeing a talking book with a face of a demon was limited to his eyes nearly bugging out of his head.
What the fuck is that?
I thought I mentioned Prime in my last letter. He's my scholomantic slash familiar. Long story, let's just say my year was a good deal less boring than I might have liked. On the plus side, I picked up several great friends. For the sake of not totally overwhelming his already overwhelmed friend, Conryu didn't mention Cerberus or the Dark Lady. Kelsey blushed, and Prime cleared his non-existent throat.
Thank you, Master.
Don't mention it. Or the Shadowhounds, for that matter. But if you want to hang out in the living room, it's fine. Prime settled on the coffee table just as Maria pushed the door open. Her arms were laden with bags and a pizza box. Conryu and Johnny both jumped up to help her with her burden. To no one's surprise, Johnny made off with the pizza box. Johnny took a deep breath and sighed.
This is what I missed the most.
Hey! Conryu punched him in the arm.
Sorry, second most.
Kelsey came to join them in the kitchen as they emptied bags of food on the counter.
She whispered, "You are so lucky. I never had friends like this. Johnny seems nice."
"Yeah, he's awesome."
Everyone gathered their snacks of choice, pizza and chips for Conryu and Johnny, while Kelsey and Maria swapped the chips for a salad. Everyone settled around the TV. He sat between the girls on the couch, and Johnny returned to the recliner. Conryu switched the baseball game on. The Sentinel soldiers were down 3 runs to the Stark Sturgeons.
"Good to see some things never change," Johnny said around a mouthful of pizza. "The bums still don't know how to play ball."
The soldiers hadn't made it to the Alliance series since before Conryu was born, and they hadn't even made it to the playoffs in 10 years. The screen went black for a second before a giant, flashing alert sign appeared, followed by a sternly attractive female anchorwoman. "We interrupt this broadcast with an important announcement. This station has received a recording from the terrorist organization known as the La Fay Society. We made this available to the city government 1 hour ago, and after they viewed it, we were assured everything is under control. Please keep that in mind as we play the message. Some of you may find it disturbing. If there are small children in the room, now would be a good time to take them out." 30 seconds later, the screen flickered, and the image of a woman in an imperial-style dragon mask appeared on the screen.
"I am Lady Dragon, interim leader of the La Fay Society. My agents have planted a number of magical weapons in Sentinel City. If our one true leader, Morgana La Fay, is not released from the Lonely Rock prison, and the abomination Conryu Coda handed over to us within 48 hours, we will unleash an army of shadow beasts that will slaughter your people by the thousands. There will be no negotiations. You will comply or die. We will contact you every 12 hours until our demands are met."
The anchor reappeared. "The mayor has assured us that the Department of Magic has this matter well under control, and the people of the city are in no danger." When she started talking about him, Conryu turned the TV off.
"Is this what Dad had you working on?" Maria asked.
Conryu found his appetite gone despite the steaming slice of pizza in front of him.
"That seems like a safe bet, though he never told me anything specific about a threat." "He wouldn't have. Dad wouldn't want you any more deeply involved in something like this than was absolutely necessary."
Outside, sirens came screaming closer and his phone rang. He answered while Kelsey ran to the window.
"There are 6 cop cars out here and men with machine guns are spilling out," she said.
"Hello?" Conryu only half listened to what Kelsey was saying.
"Aegis? Calm down. What do you mean I need to get out of the building?"
Oren watched the recording for the 5th time. He was sitting in the department conference room waiting for the mayor and his crisis team to arrive.
City Hall had sent the Society's ultimatum over 10 minutes ago, demanding to know if it was a hoax, and if it wasn't, what he was doing about it. He'd put them off by claiming he didn't want to talk about it over the phone. That bought him however long it would take the officials to make the trip from City Hall 3 blocks north of here. He turned the computer off and leaned back in his chair. They'd all known something like this was coming, despite his assurances to the contrary. He hadn't exactly lied to the mayor, but he had...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.